Welcome! So, in my younger days, before the middle-aged period that I'm going through now, where I collect dollies and expensive records and things like that, from, I would say, childhood really, but particularly from my late teens, early 20s, through to into my 30s, my biggest and most consistent collection, with the arguable exception of music and CDs really, but my biggest collection for many, many years, like close to two decades I think, was wrestling on first VHS videotape, for those of you who are annoyingly too young to remember that, and then DVD, and after that Blu-ray. What for me was like my pride and joy, it was just an absolutely massive wrestling collection during the 2000s into the 2010s. I'd every WWE or WWF pay-per-view on DVD, and there was some on Blu-ray by the end of the noughties as well. I had every WCW event on DVD. They were all copied. I sourced them from various places because they weren't officially released onto DVD in the UK or anywhere else, as far as I know. I had every ECW pay-per-view, the majority of those. In fact, I think all of those were official releases as well. And aside from this massive library of actual wrestling events that I had, I also had a great many kind of documentary and special kind of DVDs that were predominantly WWE releases via the Silver Vision company here in the UK. They handled all the distribution and releases for WWE home video in Europe. Those were the days. The collection, much as I loved building it up and I'd watched everything in it, and it was just like a nice little library, just like a complete sort of wrestling fan's paradise in the corner of the living room, really. But when I got divorced in 2011, I had to sell the bulk of my collection as I was moving into a new place, and I'd not got the room for just all these DVDs, Blu-rays, etc. So I sold the bulk of my collection then, and then I sold the rest of it about a year later before I moved to Ireland. And since then, I've never been interested in getting this massive collection back into my life, because why would I? We have the WWE Network now, or at least we do for the time being in the US. WWE content is now on Peacock, and I think there's been more things that have been taken off. But at the time of me recording this, on the whatever it is of May 2022, we here in the UK and most of the rest of the world do still have the WWE Network that contains all these old events and pay-per-views that I had on optical disc 15 years ago. And a lot of the documentary type stuff that I had on DVD and Blu-ray as well. But not everything. So I was in a bit of a wrestling documentary mood not too long ago. I went on the network. I've been a WWE Network customer ever since it's been going in this country, really. They've still got a pretty good selection of like the documentaries that were once out on WWE home video that I may have had in my own physical collection many years ago. And of course they do a lot of kind of network exclusive or Peacock exclusive documentaries and series and stuff, especially for online streaming now anyway. But it got me to thinking about how there's some of my very favourite wrestling DVDs that for whatever reason were never put up on the network, and I decided to buy some of them, and I've got four of them here today. They're all from eBay. This isn't really about how much they cost, and it's not an unboxing. I've got the DVDs here. I'm just going to talk about them one by one. I suppose it's going to be a little bit of a review, kind of a sort of anecdotal vlog, I suppose, as I kind of waffled on about my physical wrestling collection before. But I have got four DVDs here now. This doesn't mean that I'm starting to build up a massive library again, because like I say, the WWE Network, while ever it's freely available and they're not taking too much stuff off here in the UK, that's perfectly fine for me. I don't spend, you know, as much time as I did 10, 15, 20 years ago watching wrestling anyway. I'm just happy to pay £9.99 a month, watch the newest pay-per-view every month, and then watch some old documentaries and some series on there, but that's about it. But there's some stuff that I used to have in my collection that I wanted to get back because it's never been on the network, it's never gonna be on the network or Peacock, and I want to just show you each one and maybe explain why. and let me know just some brief thoughts about each DVD as well. Weirdly, I think I bought these and watched these in like the actual release order that they came out in originally. So we'll start with one that's technically not a WWE release, although it does have plenty of World Wrestling Federation footage on it. This was a feature-length documentary that I think would have come out originally maybe early 1999, possibly late 98. But I remember getting it on VHS originally, I think in 1999, and then I got a different DVD version some years later when I was kind of switching all my old VHS tapes over to disc. I'm talking about this documentary, Hitman Hart Wrestling with Shadows. This is the 10th anniversary DVD, and I decided I wanted this one specifically because there's two documentaries in this. I think it's split out over two discs. Yes, it is. The first disc has got Hitman Hart Wrestling with Shadows, and the second disc, which is like the bonus disc, features a documentary about Bret Hart's younger brother, Owen Hart. I can't really stand here for probably getting on for hours and explain the sort of whole Hart family saga to you, but I thought this was a good buy. I think I made a best offer on it and it was accepted. But I remember first seeing Hitman Hart Wrestling with Shadows, and it was just a revelation because I'd never seen all the backstage goings-on from the WWF as it was back then. I don't think any fan had, really. This was the first documentary of its kind that really pulled back the curtain for what had been quite a secretive business, really.
In the no-holds-barred world of professional wrestling,
he will always be my hero.
He's always my hero.
One man clawed his way to the top.
I love him with all my heart.
And used every trick in the book to stay there. Bret the Hitman Hart. With this exclusive documentary, go behind the scenes.
It's so hard to find a hero anywhere.
I was proud of that Hitman character. He fought for the right causes, and he spoke up, and he told the truth.
I don't think there are any good guys anymore. The guys the fans were supposed to hate are becoming the heroes.
Bang! You talk about wrestling not being real. It's far more real than people think.
Meet the gorgeous ladies.
Wow! Bret Hart touched my hand.
The family.
My parents had 8 boys and 4 girls. All 8 boys got into wrestling, and all 4 girls married wrestlers.
The father who raised a hero.
The person I've always longed to be is you.
Then, meet the man who stole the championship belt away from the Hitman.
The stage we perform on was created by Vince McMahon. He talked to me about changing my character. He wants me to become a bad guy.
I can't do that.
You'll see that professional wrestling is more vicious behind the scenes than in the ring.
I could beat this guy.
14 years with the WWF. They screwed me.
Bret screwed Bret.
Then, get ready for the Hitman's Revenge on WCW. Hitman Hart, Wrestling with Shadows. The rise, fall, and rise again of a true champion.
I am the best there is, the best there was, and the best there ever will be.
Hitman Hart, Wrestling with Shadows.
Of course, Wrestling with Shadows, for those who don't know, it's essentially a documentary, I think it's a guy called Paul Jay commissioned to make, about Bret Hart, and it covers his last year in the World Wrestling Federation and the events leading up to and including the infamous Montreal Screwjob at the 1997 Survivor Series. It's such a fascinating film. It's kind of partly responsible, this one, for my love of documentaries that stayed with me up until this very day. As a lot of people who watch this channel know, I do like documentaries. I do review them on my channel from time to time. I was going to do a more in-depth review of Wrestling with Shadows, actually, but then I decided I wouldn't because I was buying other wrestling DVDs and I wanted to just cover this a bit more concisely in this with the other three. The second disc is a documentary. It's a shorter one and it's by the same filmmaker. It reuses some footage from Wrestling with Shadows, but I think it's called, and I'm not able to see it very well here, but The Life and Death of Owen Hart, I think it's called. It's quite tragic for obvious reasons. I think a lot of people who are watching this know what happened to Owen Hart, and they'll know about Bret Hart and his brother and his family generally anyway. I was happy to pick that up, and it's not an official WWF or WWE production, even though, amazingly, thinking about how insular and stubborn Vince McMahon is, it still surprises me after all these years that he actually allowed Paul Jay and his team to be filming behind the scenes, really, for this. It was obviously, it was like a favour to Bret Hart at a time when Bret Hart was about to sign his 20-year contract with the WWF, that he was asked by Vince McMahon if he could cut that short a year later, and that led up to the infamous events in Montreal. But I'm really happy with this. The Wrestling with Shadows is the main thing. If you see this and it's a different looking sleeve, that'll be just Wrestling with Shadows. There's nothing in the way of extras on it, really. But I would recommend this particular version, because although the Owen Hart documentary could have been a bit more in depth for me, it's still a very good watch. And Wrestling with Shadows still remains one of the best independent wrestling documentaries that's ever been made. Now, the next one is a DVD that came out in 2002. It got deleted by WWE Home Video within a couple of months, really, because it was released, or it was produced, rather, around the time of the WWF having to change their name to WWE because of the court ruling regarding the World Wildlife Fund. So WWE weren't allowed to use or even have the initials WWF mentioned on their programming and on their home media stuff for quite a few years after that. And this had kind of been produced around that time where they were still able to use WWF logos and say the initials, etc. But by the time it had come out, the court ruling had come into effect, so this DVD didn't really exist for very long to buy, you know, not on the aftermarket. I'm talking about Hollywood Hogan, Hulk Still Rules. I think I got this a few years after it came out, because, I mean, I've been using eBay for donkey's years, really, and I didn't pick it up when it first came out in 2002, but it must have been about 2005, I think, that I laid my hands on one.
The new king of professional wrestling. Hulkamania is running wild.
World Wrestling Entertainment presents Hulk Still Rules, a must-have two-disc DVD. Over 4 hours of bonus footage with 15 rare and classic matches, including Hogan's WWE debut in 1979. Hulk Still Rules, available now wherever videos are
sold. I watched it back again recently, and I realised how kind of shallow the documentary is. I think at the time I thought it was pretty good. It was like a nice story of Hulk Hogan. But when you know about the man and about everything that he's done in his life and the controversies, well, I mean, there wasn't as many controversies at this point than there was in more recent years, but there was still some, you know, dating from 2002 and previous. Yeah, I was a little bit disappointed with this again when I watched it. I'm glad I've got it, because this is something that, I mean, theoretically, this could go up on the network, but I searched for it on the network and I couldn't find it. They've never really released another, like, really in-depth Hulk Hogan documentary. I don't want to be morbid or anything, but I get the feeling something like that's going to come out on the network and on Peacock, like, after he's passed away. You know, kind of like they've done with Ultimate Warrior and a couple of other now departed stars, but we'll get onto Warrior again in a bit. It's still a good watch, though, and there's some interesting extras on here. There's like a lot of sort of funny clips from Tuesday Night Titans in the 1980s, which was kind of like a cheesy WWF-centric chat show, really, talk show, hosted by Vince McMahon. But there's some matches on here. I mean, a lot of the matches will be relatively easy to find on the network, rather than you having to go out and get a DVD of them. I've never really looked for specific standalone matches on the WWE Network. If I'm wanting to watch wrestling matches, I want to watch like a whole event or the majority of an event, rather than just one match from such a time, then another from somewhere else, if you see what I mean. I suppose that's why a lot of these sets, like the ones that are sort of like best of compilations rather than documentaries, I never really gravitated towards those compilation type sets. I preferred the documentaries, but this is a two-disc set, so it's kind of best of both worlds, really. Don't think after, what, 20 years now, it's going to be put on the network. They might as well make just a new Hulk Hogan documentary, because there's so much to talk about the man, good and bad, but obviously with WWE being quite revisionist, really, when it comes to their history and the history of performers who work for them, you know, I don't think they're going to do necessarily a Hogan burial at this point, now that he returned to the Hall of Fame after the racism scandal and everything. But, I mean, this DVD came out years before all of that stuff anyway. But I'm glad I got that. It was pretty cheap as well. I was expecting that when I was looking for this, that it was even rarer now than it was back then, and it cost quite a lot of money, but it didn't. It was well under a tenner, including postage, I think. I can't remember any of the prices because some of these are picked up a couple of months ago or more now. I mentioned The Ultimate Warrior previously. There is a really good documentary on the network about him that they released really quickly after his death in, what was that, 2014. And so I get the feeling they were producing a positive documentary about him in the first place. And then what with him passing away a few days after his Hall of Fame induction, they kind of expedited matters really regarding that. I think it was one of the conditions of Warrior sort of accepting the Hall of Fame induction, because obviously he'd been at loggerheads with Vince McMahon and the WWE for many years. One of the main reasons why is because of this, the infamous burial DVD, The Self-Destruction of the Ultimate Warrior. I'd forgotten quite how sort of scathing towards Warrior this was. I mean, it's like, you watch Always Believe, the nice Warrior documentary that came out after he died, and it's like they're talking about someone you might think is like some royalty or something like that, and just a beloved WWE legend. Where if you go back to, I think this was out maybe 2005, which would have been about 9 years after his last WWF appearance at that point, there's not many people with very nice things to say about him, and rightly so, really. I mean, for all that Warrior meant to wrestling fans of a certain age, myself included, I was never a massive Warrior fan. But I grew up watching him, and he was, you know, one of the most colourful, memorable characters when I first started watching wrestling in the late 80s and early 90s. It is a complete burial, this. Bobby Heenan, God rest his soul, one of the greatest commentators and managers of all time, he absolutely despised Warrior. You could tell that just from all the sound bites and interview clips on here. Vince McMahon at this point, although, as we know, McMahon and Jim Helwig, aka Warrior, patched things up before the Hall of Fame in 2014. But Vince McMahon has some fairly stern words about Warrior. In a way, it could have been much worse, because they didn't touch upon when Warrior had been outed as like a real kind of far-right homophobe in, that would have been, I think, the early 2000s. And he was doing these university campus lecture tours where he was saying some really sort of horrible things, particularly about homosexuals and minorities. I'm amazed they didn't reference that. I mean, you know, they've got to keep it fairly light to a point, I suppose, because it's a consumer product that WWE Home Video wanted to sell. You know, there is some positivity to the self-destruction of Ultimate Warrior. You know, I think guys who were interviewed for it, like Chris Jericho and Christian, I think they were sort of kind of fans of his, really. Even though they sort of towed the company line and were sort of laughing at his loud, unintelligible promos and interviews. But you could tell Jericho, particularly, was a bit of a Warrior fan, really. Maybe in spite of himself. It's just a one-disc DVD, this. It came with its original insert as well. There's a few matches on here, so if you're a Warrior fan, even though, you know, it's not very positive about the man, about the wrestler, there's still stuff on here that like, a Warrior fan's going to enjoy, like old matches. But there's a lot of kind of cut scenes and interviews that didn't make the final documentary, where people are just basically slagging him off some more. This'll never be on Peacock or the network, that I could lay my last dollar on that, because it's too negative towards someone who now, or since 2014, WWE have welcomed back into the family, as it were. And of course, they have the annual Warrior Award that's named after the bloke at the Hall of Fame still to this day. It's well worth watching, this, if you can kind of tolerate a lot of the negativity. A lot of it's deserved. I mean, there's two sides to every story, and obviously there's only one side in here, because Ultimate Warrior never had any input into this. An interesting thing relating not so much to this, but the concept of a burial DVD, as a lot of people called it at the time. There was going to be one, a similar kind of thing, about Bret Hart. I think they planned it, and then like they'd shot a lot of interview stuff, and you know, it was almost finished really, and they were going to call it Screwed, the Bret Hart story. And Bret Hart found out about this, and he didn't want his legacy tarnished with a kind of self-destruction of Ultimate Warrior type thing. And then that was kind of what opened the door, ironically, into Bret Hart eventually being back in the WWE fold all those years after Montreal. And he got his Hall of Fame induction, and then he worked with WWE to release a positive Best of Hitman set, which had a documentary and many of his best matches on it. But there could have been a similar DVD about Bret Hart, and by all accounts, it was pretty much made and completed. Right, finally, here's one that I do remember this being quite a sort of dark, and it was quite a difficult watch in parts when I first got it. I think this was one that I got when it was a new release in 2006. This may have come out. Another performer like Hogan and Warrior and Bret Hart as well, who I'd grown up with. You know, all these are kind of my era wrestlers of the 1980s and early to mid 90s, really. As soon as I knew this one was coming out, it intrigued me back in 2006, and I managed to pick it up again more recently. And it's Pick Your Poison, Jake the Snake Roberts. I always really liked Jake Roberts. I just love these promos, that sort of quiet, sort of seething menace. People talk about ring psychology a lot, and if you watch wrestling and you study it, you get it, but it is true that Jake the Snake Roberts was kind of a master at it, really. He was never a world champion, and not a major world champion in WWE or WCW or anything anyway. Just still one of the most legendary figures, but a man who, for a large part of like the last couple of decades or more, has been more famous for problems with drug abuse and alcohol addiction, and his sort of infamous appearances and his scrapes with the law and everything like that. And surprisingly, for a WWE DVD, that a lot of their stuff can be a bit sort of overly lightweight, like the sort of Hulk Hogan, Hulk Still Rules one, for example. They don't really hold a lot back. I mean, Jake Roberts is interviewed, and the thing actually opens with like this really depressing poem. I think it's a poem rather than like an essay or something that Jake wrote at some point. And just basically a guy who at this point, you know, mid-noughties, he still was in the throes of addiction. He'd not got clean. It's quite a harrowing watch, but there is stuff in that puts him in a positive light, and it's not a burial thing because he's involved, you know. It was with his full cooperation. We see classic Jake Roberts matches and moments and things like that. A two-disc set, this. There's a load of matches and promos and stuff on the second disc. I mean, I've not really deep-dived into these extras. I think even the first time around when I owned these DVDs, I probably didn't watch all the extras for all of these. Very comprehensive if you want sort of, you know, the definitive Jake Roberts collection. It's just a little bit of a shame that this came out some years before he properly sorted his life out. I don't think it's on there anymore, but Netflix did have the Resurrection of Jake the Snake documentary, which isn't a WWE thing. That was like another independent documentary, but it was a well-received documentary from not too many years ago, which showed Diamond Dallas Page helping Jake Roberts sort his life out, and also Scott Hall, who recently departed us. It showed him on the road to recovery finally as well. It's an odd one, this, for me. It's fascinating in places. I just don't know why they released it when Jake, they didn't want him back in the company, really. Certainly not full time. He had ambitions since the early 90s to work on WWE's creative team as a booker, you know, the creative side of the non-wrestling side of the business. Just seems a weird kind of point in his life, really, because he barely had a career. He would have still been doing like indie shows and turning up intoxicated and things like that. I mean, the famous Jake the Snake in a state scenes were, of course, in Beyond the Mat. And Beyond the Mat is mentioned in here, and everyone's like really negative on it, and Jake's saying, oh, this isn't what I thought it was going to be. I like Beyond the Mat. I think it's a good documentary, and that's another one I can recommend that you seek out. Jake doesn't look good on there. He's like, there's a famous scene in his hotel room where he's actually high on crack cocaine, and he's just incoherent. A lot of this is dedicated to his life, you know, his early life before wrestling, and if you listen to some of the things he had to go through as a child and as a young adult, you can see why he turned to drink and drugs. What he went through, even now, it blows my mind. Opinions differ, but you know, as far as I'm concerned, addiction is an illness, and he had an illness. I think he's been doing fine, and he's been clean and sober and a lot more healthy in his kind of older age for the past few years, and he's now a Hall of Famer. He's someone who just goes to show, if out of all the people you didn't think would turn the life around, you'd say Jake Roberts was up there because he was so far gone. But yet, thanks to people like DDP, he was able to actually turn the corner, and hopefully that will continue. But yeah, it's depressing in places, but it's also a pretty thorough look at the career of Jake the Snake, Pick Your Poison. So that was four wrestling DVDs from eBay that aren't on the network. I don't know why Pick Your Poison isn't. I think probably because it's just like too dark, really. Jake the Snake's been covered like kind of Ultimate Warrior, and you know, Bret Hart and a lot of wrestlers of that era has been covered elsewhere by WWE in generally a more flattering and company-friendly and even fan-friendly sort of light, really. But I've only scratched the surface talking about all these documentaries here today. I'm not going to pick a favourite because they're all good and they're all watchable in their own way. As I say, if you're a WWE Network or in the US Peacock subscriber, you're not going to find these. I mean, you're never going to find Wrestling with Shadows on there because it's not a WWE production, but you're not going to find the other three, the Hogan, Warrior and Jake the Snake documentaries on the network. Do what I did if you're interested in watching them, and look on eBay, because all of these, like, I paid well under a tenner for all of them. You know, I think one of them, I think it might have been the Warrior DVD, I think it was like £5 including postage. But there we are. I hope you enjoyed this slightly different video from me today. Kind of reminiscing about my old wrestling collection, and then talking about some documentaries that I've picked up that I've enjoyed watching again after all these years, that are interesting for various reasons, but they've all got something in common in that they're not available to stream on the network. Special thanks go to my wonderful subscribers and generous patrons. Please see my Patreon link and my Facebook group link down in the description text box. I'm going to go now, and let me know in the comments what you think. Did you have a wrestling collection on video, on DVD, Blu-ray, etc., physically before streaming got really popular sort of 10 years ago, and now everything's done online? I was so proud of my collection. Still have fond memories of it, but it would have been pretty much next to useless now. Apart from stuff like this, of course, that's not available digitally and that you do have to seek out still on eBay like I did back in the day originally. If you want to chat about wrestling and about this era of wrestling and the wrestlers I've mentioned in the comments, then please do. I'd love to hear from you. But until then, please will you join me again next time for my next video. Cheers, everyone. See ya.